I hate where I live. It's not a secret. I've said it before, said it a billion times, but I really do hate where I live. I know you're just like, Jay, this is supposed to be a channel about your screenwriting journey. Why do you keep coming back to this topic of your apartment and all the things that you go through here? And it's because it is relevant to my screenwriting journey. I feel like my home is supposed to be my sanctuary. It's supposed to provide me a place where I can write, where I can create, where I can thrive without too much issue, without being molested, without being bothered, without being interrupted. And unfortunately, that just has not been the case. Yeah, as I've said before, I hate the fact that I just live far. I live far from the action. And while I'm not going to reveal exactly where I live, just know I live far enough away from where all of the real Los Angeles shenanigans go down. It makes networking difficult. It makes socializing difficult. And had I really thought about it when I made this move in the middle of the pandemic, I don't know if I would have actually moved. But at the time, I was going through it mentally. I needed to get away. I needed space. I needed to just get away from people. And that's what I did. I was fooled into thinking that this was kind of a nice, quiet area, but whatever. It served its purpose at the time, and perhaps that is what I needed. But more than just like the distance, the actual location, what I really, really hate are the people. And by people, I mean my neighbors. This is my second apartment at this complex. My first apartment, I was on the ground floor and I had upstairs neighbors that just seemed to stomp around and they were just the noisiest motherfuckers on earth. And after enduring that for several months, I found another apartment within the complex. It was an upper level apartment. I would have no one above me, and I thought that my problems would be solved. But that really was not the case. For I soon discovered that my next door neighbor was an aspiring rapper who treated his apartment as if it was a recording studio. But I will be honest. Recently, they've kept the music and the noise down. I think it's partly because they had to find work. It was revealed to me by someone who's no longer working at the apartment complex that my neighbor was one of those people who took advantage of the rent moratorium, but now that that shit basically came to an end, it's just like, gotta figure that shit out. But just judging by how my neighbors have been moving lately, I think that they had to get day jobs, and that has definitely led to a decrease in noise, much more importantly, music coming from next door. But then there's also the family that moved in below me. And when I say family, I do mean a family unit with a child. A child who is, I found out, 9 years old. 9 years old. Now I've talked about dealing with them before, going downstairs to ask them to keep it down, especially when the 9-year-old screams at the top of her lungs or sings Alicia Keys' Girl on Fire.
This girl is on fire!
As loud as she possibly can. It was an interesting conversation, the last one that I had with them. And if you recall, in a previous video, I even learned that I've been a noisy upstairs neighbor. You see, the grandfather that lives below me sleeps in the living room of the one-bedroom apartment beneath me, and I would run my dishwasher in the wee hours of the morning, like 2, maybe even 3 in the morning. I would run my dishwasher before I go to bed, not thinking that it would bother anyone below me because, well, my kitchen is presumably above their kitchen, but it's not above, like, a bedroom. So after discovering this, I decide to do the neighborly thing and say, hey, I will stop running my dishwasher so late or whatever so that I don't disturb the grandfather's sleep. It's partly because I understand what that is. For a very long time, I myself slept on the couch in living rooms. My friends were nice enough to let me crash in their living room, and I slept on the couch. So whatever their situation is down there, hey, I was being sympathetic. A couple of weeks after that conversation, I'm sitting at my desk, reading, not moving, not doing anything, silently reading, when I hear a banging on my floor. I'm not gonna lie, y'all, I thought I was going crazy. It's like, what the hell is this? Maybe there's some pipe or something that is acting up. I had no fucking idea. And I heard the banging again, and so I decided to stomp in response. And then there was banging in response to my stomping, so I stomped, and more banging. And that's when I realized, of course, that whoever was underneath me was banging on the ceiling. So I grabbed my keys and I went downstairs and I knocked on the door to find out what the fuck was going on. But of course, whoever was banging on the ceiling, they weren't brave enough to come to the door. This was probably at like 11:30 at night. So I decided that I was going to speak to my neighbors at some point. The next day I went downstairs, knocked on the door again, but no one answered. Okay, fine. Maybe a day or two after that, getting ready to go, and I see the grandfather walking around outside. So I approach him, and he's with another young man. The young man turns out to be his son, and the son doesn't live in the apartment beneath me. So I ask the grandfather, I'm just like, hey, were you banging on the ceiling the other night? And he's very hostile, and he's just like, yes, yes I was. I was like, why, what's going on? Every night, you're walking around, and I'm just like, whoa, all right. I've lived underneath people before, and I know what it is when people are walking around and causing noise, and they say that they don't know, and I honestly didn't know. But in our previous discussion, did I not tell you to come and talk to me if I'm ever doing anything above you that's disrupting what y'all do? And what's funny is, this man, again, you know, he's very hostile and just very, you know, like he doesn't want to hear what I'm saying. But I was just like, yeah, I told you and your daughter and your granddaughter that if I'm up here fucking around, making noise, you can always knock on my door and tell me. I'm not gonna yell at you, I'm not gonna scream at you, I'm not gonna whatever. I'm gonna figure out what it is and also figure out how to stop doing it. I told him, look, I work late, I'm cooking dinner, I'm living my life. It's not my fault that you're sleeping in the living room. But had you come to me and said something, could have figured something out. But his hostility in that moment really started to piss me off. And then the other thing that pissed me off was realizing that, okay, apparently whatever I've been doing up here has been bothering him for so long that he let the resentment build up that he started banging on the ceiling. Even after I said, just please come talk to me. So that lets me know that whatever I'd been doing had been bothering them for a while and they hadn't said anything. And all the time that I'd seen them or whatever, never said anything. So finally, I said to his son, I was just like, you know, I talked to your father and I talked to your sister about our noise issues and how we all have to live together and how the little girl is loud and everything. And how I also said, if I'm ever bothering you, to come let me know. But then I explained to the son, I was just like, dude, if I was trying to be an asshole and like make noise or like whatever and disrupt everybody's life, then why would I offer to stop washing my dishes at night after your father told me that it wakes him up? And the son was just like, oh, word? Like, dad? And father couldn't even say anything. When I mentioned that, father looked away. I was like, yeah, I'm not an asshole. Like, if you let me know, I'll see what I can do to like stop making the noise, to stop disrupting your life. Not a dickhead. I'm a nice neighbor. And the son was just like, all right, well, you know, I'm gonna talk to my dad and, you know, whatever. And I was like, yeah, please do. Cause I don't want him banging on the fucking floor anymore. And I'm not gonna lie, y'all, like after that, I was just like, all goodwill is thrown out the window. If I had been careful about, you know, not stomping around or like whatever, fuck that. You know, you're not gonna out asshole me. And I even just thought about, you know what? Fuck him, I'm just gonna run my dishwasher whenever I want. But I've still not run my dishwasher late at night because I know he's underneath me in the living room sleeping after a certain time. I will say that the little girl has calmed down. Like she hasn't been singing, hasn't been screaming. There are occasions where she will play outside in front of the apartment and that comes into my apartment, you know, and it's a little loud, but you know, it is what it is. She's outside playing and it's annoying, but what can you do? Although I wish that her mother and grandfather would realize that they're letting her play like in the little field where everybody takes their dog to piss and shit. But hey, you know, that's on them. And it's kind of bittersweet. One of my other neighbors, who I like a lot, is moving away. One of the very few people around here who's like cool, but he's moving away. But I'm also kind of glad he's moving because he has a couple of dogs. And when he lets his dogs like outside to like run around, the little girl is outside. She'll play with the dogs, and one of the dogs is named Kobe, like Kobe Bryant. This little girl will just be like, Kobe, 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 for like 30, 45 minutes straight. And it sounds like it's right outside my door, and it's just like, oh my God. Y'all, I've said this before, I'm like Melvin Udall, you know, Jack Nicholson's character in As Good As It Gets. I need a reasonable level of quiet in order to work, in order to write. And it's impossible when you have hip hop beats thumping so loud that they rattle your wall, or you have a little 9-year-old girl who doesn't understand the concept of inside voice and who's just so loud and energetic at all times, the day and night. It's just difficult. It's really difficult. I haven't even talked about the neighbor that lives behind me who also likes to bump their music as loud as fucking possible in the middle of the day, like nobody's at home working. And y'all, I get that this is apartment living, but I swear, I've lived in apartments for the past, I don't know, 25 years. And this is the worst experience ever. And I've lived in New York, I've lived in Miami. This is the worst shit ever, ever. And it's largely because people don't care. People do not care. They don't care about the people around them. They don't care how their actions affect anyone else. People are selfish. And it just blows my mind. And you know, the other thing is that I've come to discover that neighbors don't care to be neighborly. You know, when I lived in New York, your neighbors knew who you were. People spoke. Like when they came out of the, you know, the house, the building, and they saw, people would wave, say hello. We had block parties, so, you know, everyone could congregate, you know, eat, party, dance, and do also. You, as a matter of fact, if you've seen the viral dance party that was taking place in Brooklyn over the pandemic, that was literally like my old block, like right in front of my old building. You know, they used to have that set up to have block parties throughout the summer and everything. That was literally in front of my old building where all that shit was taking place. That just lets you know how my old neighborhood used to get down, or how my old neighborhood gets down. But since I've been here in California, it's nothing like that. There's no sense of community at all. None whatsoever. Like, I am surprised that I got as cool as I did with my neighbor who is moving, probably because we're both black men, you know. But for the most part, people are just assholes to each other out here. They really are. And this apartment complex, I mean, I don't even know what the hell is going on. Everyone, as far as staff, has left, which is crazy to me. When I first moved in, I got to know the staff. I got to know, you know, the property manager, you know, like all the leasing agents, the maintenance staff, everyone was cool. I don't know what's happened, like within the past, I'd say like 2 months, but they've all, like within like this 2 month period, they've all left. Everyone in the office is new. I don't know what the shit is going on, but that to me is a signal that this property is going downhill. And I believe it. I believe it. I'd been looking to move at the beginning of the year. That didn't work out. So I just did some foolish shit. And I'm pretty much stuck here for a little while longer, but it's okay. I do have a plan. I'm gonna stick this out for the rest of the year. But I've decided that when I do move, it can't be to a large property like this. I think that I would do much better in a smaller situation. Maybe a smaller building, smaller property, one with a very few units, one that probably doesn't have like a corporate owner, but like a private landlord or whatever, and a situation in which there are no children. I'm really surprised that I have lived in apartments this long where I haven't had to live around kids. Just even my Brooklyn apartment, my next door neighbors, children didn't live in those buildings. No children lived in my building. That makes a world of difference. So we'll see. Cause like I said, this situation is not ideal. It is not ideal for the writer's lifestyle that I'm trying to cultivate for myself. And for those of you who are going to tell me, hey, just buy a house, bro, no, just no. No. That's not within the realm of possibility at this moment. So I'll figure it out though. I always do. Thank you for watching and listening to me vent. Don't be an asshole neighbor. Kobe.